Hey there, and welcome back to another episode of the Profitable Mindset Podcast.
Welcome to the Profitable Mindset, a show dedicated to teaching you the skills you need to build a profitable product-based business that makes you feel free and fully in control. Here's your host, Charlotte Smith.
Okay, now I want to move into part two, all about managing employees. This is different from hiring. We're going to talk about managing, and a key thing here is you want to have very clear expectations in your mind. You want to know what you want them to do and how it should be done, and you want to communicate these. They can't just be stuck in your mind. You got to communicate them. You got to write them down. You got to have them in an Excel spreadsheet or a Google sheet that you can share with them so they have it on their phone, so they're always clear on the expectations. You don't want to just say, hey, can you unload that truckload of 6 tons of hay? You want to know where you want the hay stacked and how you want the hay stacked, and you want to communicate that to them. So you don't come out when it's all done and notice they put it in the wrong location and the bales are facing the wrong way, okay? We all have these expectations in our mind, but you've got to learn to communicate them. Again, I learned it the hard way. At first, I assumed so many things. I just assumed, for instance, that everyone knows you don't show up 10 minutes late every single day for a job. I assumed that everyone just comes to the job on time, unless an exception comes up, like you have a rare flat tire. I just assumed that that's how the world works because that's how I was raised and my other employees showed up on time. But just because I think that way does not mean other people think that way. So make sure you communicate that. Here's another. I also assumed that people would wear deodorant and smell acceptable, or at least not be offensive smelling to the people or customers around them. Guess what? That's not always the case. It's not necessarily common sense. I've had to have hard conversations around hygiene. So plan to have this info included up front. Have it written down what you expect of them. Remember, you might be hiring from a pool of people who are not as sophisticated as others, so you might have to spell out more of these things. And don't get angry. That doesn't help anything. It's just reality. So accepting the reality that not everyone is inside your brain, as common sense as much common sense as might be in there. Not everyone thinks that way. Just know this and accept that you have to spell out all your expectations. It's going to help tremendously. All right. So here's another one. I thought everyone in the world knows that you don't climb over a gate. You're going to break the gate. The hinges are going to sag. It's so much work. But guess what? New employees to a farm think it's so cool to climb over a gate instead of going through it. So now that's in our training program. Now, you go through a gate. Nobody goes over a gate. You close the gate behind you. So all these things you think are common sense to you, start thinking of them now, getting them down on paper in a Google sheet that you can share, and you've got to communicate them. Doing so makes you a great employer. This makes you someone that people want to work for. Another skill in managing employees is to give direct feedback. And I love to have a really specific time to give direct feedback. It's going to happen more often in the first 30 or 60 or 90 days, of course, while they're new and you're training them. But ongoing, even my employee, you know, after 5 years, I make sure we have a stand-up meeting every Monday. Stand-up just means we're standing there in the barn, we're out in the field, it's 10, 15 minutes. That's when I get a chance to give direct feedback. I also ask them regularly in every meeting, is there anything I can do to help you do your job better? And I let them give me direct feedback. This has created such great trust between us. They know I have their back, and so they can tell me anything. They know that. It makes our relationship much more easy, and they appreciate my directness and the trust. There's mutual trust there. And Sometimes I'm direct in the moment. Like if they're doing something wrong in the moment and I happen to oversee it, I can give direct feedback right there. You don't have to stew about it forever. And we have that trust because of our weekly stand-up meetings that allows me to do that with care and compassion, and I don't do it with criticism. But if I see something out on the farm, like they didn't do this thing quite right and I want them to do it differently, and then we have our Monday morning stand-up meeting a few days later because I wasn't with them, you know, maybe they weren't around and I saw that they did something wrong, then I give that feedback in that Monday morning meeting. And I always make sure the direct feedback is about the behavior they need to correct or the performance they need to improve. I make sure it is sandwiched by genuine compliments. I'm going to point out the things they're doing correctly so that we continuously build trust between us. You need your employees to trust you for sustainability reasons. You want them to know that you give really specific feedback and you're very direct, and you still appreciate them and appreciate their work. If you're just giving critical feedback all the time, they're going to learn not to trust you, and they're going to go get another job eventually. It's not pleasant long term. Okay, and now, two, make sure when you're giving feedback that you're communicating with your voice tone and with your mindset that you've worked on. My coaching clients know what I'm talking about, that you're communicating the feedback in a way that obviously means nothing about them as a person. You're only talking about the work. The work is unacceptable, but you're not unacceptable. You're not a bad person. And you communicate that with your voice tone. Be very intentional that you're communicating it that way. And you're communicating it in a way that also says, hey, let's figure out together how we can solve this problem. Let's figure this out. Let's collaborate, come up with a solution. How can I help you in this situation? How can I help you remember to close the gates that you open? You know, it doesn't matter what you're talking about. When you offer this in a way that means you are focused on the solution that you come up with, they'll trust you. And also what happens when you do this, when you immediately move to collaborate, to focus on a solution, there's no dwelling on any kind of negative feedback. You give the direct feedback about what they need to improve or what they did wrong. And then you say, let's figure out the solution to correct this. And there's no dwelling in negativity. And not one moment is spent worrying about, oh, does she think I'm a bad person? Because you've already moved on to the solution. So that's why you want to make sure that you communicate, hey, let's figure out how we can fix this. Now, let's talk about pay. With managing employees, I want you to pay high. I want you to increase your prices if you have to pay a good, solid wage. The more I pay higher wages, the more high quality people I attract. You still will get ones that apply that don't fit, but don't pay bottom of the barrel minimum wage, or you will attract people who can only get a low end job for certain reasons, and those reasons are not going to work out for you long term. Those people are going to turn over very quickly, or you're just not going to be happy with their performance. I start at $15 an hour, sometimes more depending on their skill and what I'm hiring them for. So maybe they'll get a raise up to $20 an hour. My employee that's been with me the longest gets $25 an hour. So it can depend on a lot of things, plus the cost of living where you live. I live in an area where the living wage is $20 an hour. So minimum wage will not attract the right person for us. I've got to pay more. So I pay high and then I give bonuses. On our farm, everybody gets unexpected bonuses. I'll hand out meat or eggs or cash. Or if someone chooses to work, I always ask for volunteers who wants to work on Christmas Day. I'm so appreciative. They get a fat cash bonus when they show up that day. It's sitting right there with a card and an envelope telling them how much I appreciate them. I love giving random unexpected bonuses because it helps create an atmosphere where they appreciate working for you because they know you appreciate them and their commitment to work for you or go the extra mile and do things carefully or work on a holiday. All right, now, fourth in managing people is No dragging your heels on things that need to be fixed or pretending that things are okay in the relationship. Don't do this. One of the worst things you can do is have an employee that you're not happy with their performance, and so you're talking about it behind their back to your partner or spouse, or God forbid, other employees, or even out in the community, but you're not telling them directly. If you find yourself going in your house to your spouse and saying, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe they did this thing again. I'm so annoyed." If you're doing that, you're not managing as a CEO of your business, which means you've not worked on your mindset. You've got to learn to be confident and direct. Remember the episode on confidence. You have to be willing to be courageous and directly tell an employee they need to change or improve their performance. You may think something like, "But that's so hard." But you guys, this is business ownership. You signed up for hard. When you decided to run a business, especially a farm business, hard is a given. So being direct, communicating what needs to be improved is a skill you'll want to develop quickly. Be open, be honest right there when it's happening. I had to learn this too, the hard way, of course. And my cue I had to learn it was, I was going into the house to my husband, complaining to him about a certain employee being consistently daily 10 minutes late to start, but putting that 10 minutes on her time sheet. So she was getting paid about an extra hour each week. And I just would go in and complain about how it bugged the heck out of me. I realized I was doing the thing I'm telling you here not to do. So I tapped into my courage like I teach you. It felt terrible, but that's what courage is for. Courage does not feel good because you need it in the presence of hard things. So tapped into the courage. I had the difficult conversation with her. Of course, she got defensive and all that, but that's part of it. I requested she change her behavior and it built trust between us. Whereas the talking behind her back, complaining, they sense it. It increases the mistrust. And if you realize right now that maybe you've been putting off some difficult conversations and not giving feedback, you've been withholding it, it's okay. It's not too late to start now. You can turn it around. I turned it around. And you can implement these weekly meetings too. If you haven't done that yet with your employees, give it a try. Explain to them why you're doing it. "Hey, it's for me to give you feedback and it's for you to give me feedback." Trust me, they'll appreciate it. This way, things you need to communicate or things they need to communicate to you don't drag on for weeks building resentment. I was not always able to give direct, instant feedback because it feels terrible. I had to work up to having the skill to do it. But I've learned in the long run, it's a lot easier to do it than to not do it. The quicker, the better you give this direct feedback, you maintain more trust. And then there's mutual respect. And you aren't left with that stress and strain and anxiety eating away at you while you're gossiping about them behind their back. Now, not all people will take your feedback and improve their performance. I've had employees that I've had to tell them the same thing time and time again, and they didn't improve their performance. You may have to decide to let them go. Here's what I'm going to tell you. I developed a belief over the years that serves me, and you might want to consider this belief. I believe that if I have to fire someone, it's my fault. It's not their fault. It's my fault because I didn't do all the things I should have done at the beginning to make sure they were very well qualified. I did not work hard enough to find the right person. Now, if you never choose to believe this, if you think, "No, it's totally their fault if I have to fire someone," you're going to find that you're going to hire the wrong people because you have an easy out. You can always blame them. "Well, I hired them and then they failed. It's their fault." No, what happens is when you take responsibility that if you ever have to fire someone, it is your fault. It's on you because you did not do your due diligence. What I'm telling you is you're going to start being more thorough. You're going to step it up. You're going to be a better business owner when you believe that. So consider believing that. That if you have to fire someone, it's your fault. You didn't work hard enough up front. So back to not everyone will improve their performance. And you may have to decide to let them go. Don't drag your feet on letting someone go. A lot of people drag their feet and they've been keeping someone on for months or even years, even though they knew it was the wrong person and the person will never be able to do what they need them to do. But they kept them on for years and years out of guilt or obligation or whatever reason. You guys, this drags you down. It keeps your business stuck, not progressing, not growing, not reaching profitability. You're really hurting your business. So don't pretend someone's doing a good job, or don't make excuses for their lack of performance. Don't say, oh, but they're going through a hard time in life, so I'm going to give them a little leeway. No, as humans, we have a hard time at life regularly. Life is, the human condition is about having a hard time on average 50% of the time. That is the human experience. You've got to be able, well, when you hire employees, they and you have to be able to have a hard time going on in your life, have hard things happen, and you pull it together for your job. We have all had to do it, and your employees will do it too. When you have the expectation, then you can be compassionate about them having a hard time and they can still perform. What happens is when you think that way, you're actually helping them. You're supporting them with trust. And the thought that, yeah, you're having a hard time and I know you can do this job anyway. You're going to build their confidence when you do that. So it's in your best interest as the CEO of your business to accept that everyone's going to have hard times all the time, regularly. It's part of life, and they can still do the job you expect them to do to the level you expect them to do it. That is you acting from a place of compassion, maybe even empathy. So yes, I'm very direct and honest in my feedback, and I'm also extremely supportive and caring. And I hear from my employees often that I'm the best boss they've ever had. So here I am, direct. I have high expectations. I want them to become better and better, and yet they thrive in that environment. So I want to share with you that they appreciate the directness and the care in how I correct them or teach them how to do things properly. So you can be direct and honest and supportive and caring and compassionate, all wrapped up in one. They're going to appreciate it. You're going to have the most loyal employees ever, and you're going to love it. They're going to love working for you because you've created this environment where you have high expectations, but the love and compassion and the way you treat them is so fulfilling for everyone. And this comes because you did your hard work up front in hiring them. The other thing I do when they say, or that they say they've not experienced elsewhere, is daily I find ways to point out something they're doing well. Most people will comment that the employers they've always had only ever pointed out what they were doing wrong. So make sure that you as the employer have daily positive feedback. Like, hey, I like the way you put those buckets back neatly. Looks great. I like the way you cleaned out that whatever. It could just be positive feedback about any little thing. You're going to see them brighten up and stand up straighter. Then they'll be more eager to change the low performance issue when that comes up because you've treated them with such appreciation the rest of the time. When you are focusing on what they do right, then what happens is this requires a higher level of thinking from you as the boss. All right? Focusing on what they do right is a skill you will develop. This is going to require you to grow in your mindset, the business owner, the CEO. It'll make you better. And you want to grow and develop your mindset if you're going to make your business successful. Okay, here's another thing. Do not hire, again, I learned this the hard way. Don't hire someone because you want to help them out. I've made this mistake. I hired people in the past because they were going through a divorce and they just needed a job. And I felt a desire to help them because they were a friend of a friend. But I learned you've got to separate the two. You can help people, you know, when you're in your house and you're talking to your friend and she's going through a divorce and having a hard time, you can help her as a friend. But as the CEO, the owner of your business, when you're hiring, you've got to be in the mindset of a confident leader. If you hire a new hire, make sure you hire that person because it is the best person for that job at that moment and will best serve your business. If you hire someone from the mindset of, oh, I'm going to help out my friend and hire her for this job, you will not have success. That lack of leadership will come back to bite you. You owe it to your business, first and foremost, to hire people that serve your business, not people that fulfill your desire to help someone who might be down and out. You get to fulfill that desire to help people when you're not in work hours. Okay, so step outside of the role of being CEO of your business. Help them from a place of being a giving, caring human being. Give them the leg up. Maybe that's a listening ear. Maybe it's a referral to someone that might be able to help them. Maybe you give them $50. Maybe you give them some food, something from your farm. Do not do your business a disservice by giving them a job from a place of feeling obligated to help or feeling sorry for them. That's no feelings drive our actions. And the action you take in hiring someone from a place of guilt and obligation and sorry is going to result in terrible results, okay? So just don't do it. Step into being the CEO of your business and hire people who can get the job done. This is you being the leader. All right, as usual, you can see that running a business, setting up a business for profitability and success is more about mindset than anything else. If you want to work on your mindset, you're ready to invest time and money into that, you can consider working with me in my coaching program. Go to 3cowmarketing.com/strategy. You can sign up for a free strategy session there. And that session is used for you to decide to invest in coaching, which will up-level your whole life. Through coaching, you'll learn how to be the confident CEO of your own life and business. You know, I often hear from my coaching clients, it heals their marriage, made their marriage better. The things that hold people back in farming is not because you don't have the right cows, or you don't have the right flowers, or you don't have the right piece of land. Those things can be fixed. The thing that holds us back 100% of the time is our mindset. It affects everything. It determines if you increase your prices. It determines if you hire correctly. So make sure you are looking into that if you're feeling stuck. If you find yourself blaming other people or your circumstances for your problems, that is a mindset issue that you can tackle. Okay, so sign up for a strategy session if you want to consider coaching. All right, take care. I'm going to see you in the next episode.
Thank you so much for tuning in to today's episode. For more great resources, check out theprofitablemindset.com. See you next time.